What's that?
It's about that thing.
What is that?
It's a chair.
Let's try it. Let's see if this works.
Yeah, I feel. Okay, you want your water in front of you, right?
Well, just when I stand up, not right now necessarily. Do you know how to move this chair to, do you have to move it? See how they lock together with it? There you go. Let me see what he has.
Just to see what happens. Right?
Yeah.
May put you up too high, but that's okay here.
Well.
I Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to God's House today as we continue a sermon series that we've been in during the summer weeks called One Anothering. The sermon series is listed on the front of the bulletin cover. And if you look there already, you'll notice that we've reached a week where we pray for one another. May God help us to do that. Also in our service this morning, we're going to be installing and recognizing the elected men in our congregation. We'll be doing that after the sermon today, so you can look for that there. And we'll have a children's devotion as well. We welcome anyone who's tuning in with us online. The bulletin was posted on our church website, so you can print it off of there or open it up and follow along. Or you can just watch and enjoy the service here. The hymns are printed in the back of the bulletin. We'll begin by singing the opening hymn. God bless our worship.
Thank you.
the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let us worship Him. Son of man, stand up on your feet, and I will speak to you. As he spoke, the Spirit came into me and raised me to my feet, and I heard him speaking to me. He said, Son of man, I am sending you to the Israelites, to a rebellious nation that has rebelled against me. They and their ancestors have been in revolt against me to this very day. The people to whom I am sending you are obstinate and stubborn. Say to them, this is what the Sovereign Lord says. And whether they listen or fail to listen, for they are a rebellious people, they will know that a prophet has been among them. And you, son of man, do not be afraid of them or their words. Do not be afraid, though briars and thorns are all around you, and you live among scorpions. Do not be afraid of what they say or be terrified by them, though they are a rebellious people. You must speak my words to them, whether they listen or fail to listen. For they are rebellious. But you, son of man, listen to what I say to you. Do not rebel like that rebellious people. Open your mouth and eat what I give you. Then I looked, and I saw a hand stretched out to me, and it was a scroll, which he unrolled before me. On both sides of it were written words of lament and mourning and woe. And he said to me, Son of man, eat what is before you. Eat this scroll. Then go and speak to the people of Israel. So I opened my mouth, and he gave me the scroll to eat. Then he said to me, Son of man, eat this scroll I am giving you, and fill your stomach with it. So I ate it, and it tasted as sweet as honey in my mouth. Then he said to me, Son of man, go now to the people of Israel, and speak my words to them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. My way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecutions, sufferings, what kinds of things happened to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra, the persecutions I endured. Yet the Lord rescued me from all of them. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evildoers and imposters will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing in his kingdom, I give you this charge. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. For the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. But you, keep your head in all situations, endure hardship, do the work of an evangelist, discharge all the duties of your ministry. This is the word of the Lord.
Please be seated now as we'll offer a children's message at this time. Any young children are welcome to come sit on the floor here in the front. First first one you have here is your pinky. So grab your pinky. And then say with me, the smallest ones. Can you say that with me? The smallest ones. One more time. The smallest ones. So this means that we can pray for people who are little, who are weak, who are small, who are having trouble, who are poor, people who really need our prayers. So we pray first of all for the smallest ones. Then the second one, you know, this is one where people wear the ring. So you can say, ones we love. Can you say that?
Ones we love.
So here, now you're thinking of your church, your friends, people who are close to you, people who you would naturally pray about. Then it comes to the tallest finger, and you could say, the tall ones. Ready?
The tall ones.
Now, I don't mean people who are just tall, that they're physically tall. We have a couple of those in our congregation. But we're thinking of leaders, people who are leading our country, people who lead our church, people who are in charge, who might lead your school, people who lead at home, because those people really need our prayers too. Now this one is the one that we don't point with this one. We point with this one. So this one is people we point at. Can you say that?
People
we point at. These are ones that you might not always be happy with. You driver, cut me off. Maybe your parents get mad at that. Or that person at school, they don't get along with me. So people you might want to point, we want to pray for them too. Not just people we love, but people also maybe that we would point at. And then this one is the one that's closest to you, your thumb. So you can say, me. Can you say that?
Me.
So last of all, we would say, what do I need? Or what's on my mind? Or what we can pray about with ourselves. Not first, though. So repeat after me. The small ones.
The small ones.
Those we love.
Those we love.
The tall ones.
The tall ones.
People we point at.
People we point at.
Me. Okay, so maybe you could remember that on your own. Maybe your parents or grandparents, maybe they can help you to remember that when you pray, because we pray for others besides us. Let's pray now. Lord God, we thank you for the privilege of prayer, that we can speak to you, and that we can also come to you on behalf of others. Help us to do this often, Lord God, in our prayers, and we pray that you would hear and answer us. Amen. We'll see you later. We'll continue with the next hymn. a new army colonel was ready for his new office. And he came into his new office and his new place there, and he looked around and he sat down and he really wanted to impress people by himself as they walked in there. And so he did a few things. He put all of his diplomas, any medals he ever won, up on the wall. He put pictures of himself shaking hands with very famous military people and politicians around the room. He had a very, very large and brassy nameplate that he put right on the front of his desk. And he had a nameplate installed on his door. And then he sat back and he put his feet up on his desk and he wondered how impressed people would be when they would come into his office. Then he heard a knock on the door. It was a private. And he said, "Come on in." And as the private answered, he grabbed the phone and he began to bark into it. He began to say, "Yes, General, I totally agree with you. I certainly agree with that point. And I will call the president later today about it." "No, sir, no, I won't forget. I'll make sure I call him." And he hung up the phone. Then he turned to the private and he said, "Yes." "Well, sir," said the private, "I've come here to hook up your phone." That colonel kind of learned a lesson that day. He learned a lesson about how we think about others and the impression we can give and how humiliating it might be when we're obviously not doing that. That attitude of that colonel is the opposite of what we want to learn today. About how we think and what our perspective is. We're not self-absorbed in ourselves and our lives and what we do and our importance, but we're going to be thinking about others in a bit more of a compassionate way. And the Word of God is going to teach us from Ephesians chapter 6 to pray for one another. As we do that today, let's offer a prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. We'll read the brief sermon text today, which is back on page 14 today as well. Pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray also for me, that whenever I speak, words may be given me, so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly, as I should. Well, I certainly think those verses are clear, very clear. I don't think anyone can read those verses and come away and not hear the point that we should pray for one another. In fact, I think everyone who's here today would probably say pretty quickly, and I will. I will pray for others. But will you? Will you really? If we could have a short sermon today, and we could end right there, and we could go off to our week and off to our schedule, and with your pledge in hand, you will pray for one another. I don't know, maybe we should look at your history. How is your history on praying for others? And I'm not talking about your family, just them, and just the ones that you love and might get closest to you. Here we're talking about people who are in wider circles. Maybe we can even extend it wider. How do you pray for others at all? When was the last time you prayed for your boss? Or if you're retired now, when was the last time that you prayed for your boss when you were working? How regularly did you do that? When was the last time you did pray for your neighbors? When was the last time you prayed for your city leaders? What is the history of prayer for workers in our community who work day and night to keep us safe and to do a lot of things that we often don't know? When was the last time that you prayed for your children's or your grandchildren's teachers? When was the last time you prayed for our president? When was the last time that you even prayed for your enemies. Jesus does say to pray for your enemies. When was the last time you prayed for that person who really doesn't like you and that you made wrong with you? What is your history on praying for other people? And if it's not great, well, we better spend some time here talking about this. And we're not even talking about random people out there, people you might know, people you don't know. But this says, pray for one another. Our sermon text specifically talks about your church, brothers and sisters. We have 125 people in our congregation. How many of the 125 have you prayed for in the last 2 weeks, or month, or 4 or 6 months? You know, when we look back, it suddenly seems like we really don't succeed at this too often. And yet Paul tells us the urgency of all of this. In fact, in the Greek, it's very, very much emphasized. In verse 18, there's 4 words for all, every. It says in verse 18, pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. Be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints. Enough said? It's an urgency that we have about us as we live in the times that we live in. What would keep you from doing this? Or what does keep you from doing this? I know you're busy. We're all busy, aren't we? We have so much to do and so much to jam on our schedule and places to go and things to do and work and so many things. But there also is that selfish side of us that no matter how busy the day might lead us not to be thinking of our brothers and sisters in faith here at our church and in our city. Have you ever done that in just a simple conversation? Has this ever happened to you? Have you ever been talking to someone and having a conversation? Maybe they're talking about something that is happening in their life or a problem that they have or something going on. And they're going on, and you zone out and go over here while they are talking to you. So they're talking to you and having this conversation. Suddenly you're doing your taxes. You're thinking about what you're doing next week. You're thinking about the problem that your child or grandchild or your cousin has. And you kind of come back and they kind of finish and pause and look at you. And you kind of say, yeah, I understand. We can even zone out and go to ourselves during the conversation. It's that side of us, that simple side, that gravitates to our own selfishness. Will you pray? Today, may we make the pledge. Yes, let us pray for one another. That'll lead us to a second question today. Why do we assume God will listen? So when we finally come back to it, we fold our hands and we bow our heads and we think about others and the needs that we might be able to pray about. Why would God even listen to us? Is that something we would take for granted as well? Maybe we think to ourselves, well, yeah, it's me. It's good on me coming to God. What's not to like? Why wouldn't God listen to me after all I've done for him? After all my hard works and acts of charity and good works that I have done, why would God not listen to me? But anyone who honestly examines themselves has to realize he should listen to us. That's the bald truth. God should not listen to us. Imagine this scene. Imagine there's a 5-year-old that you know, and the 5-year-old sometimes has a mean streak in them, and they're having one today. And they're kind of picking on you. You ever have someone younger pick on you? Maybe they're finding it funny to walk behind you and step on your heels while you're walking. And you turn around, you scold them about that. And then they laugh and they kind of run away, and you're in a crowd or a gathering, whatever, and they start throwing couples at you. And they kind of run away. And then they get a piece of broken glass and they scratch your car door. And then let's say suddenly you hear the ice cream truck coming up the street. It's got the speaker on. And the 5-year-old comes running up to you and says, hey mister, can you buy me an ice cream? Can you give me some money for an ice cream? Are you buying ice cream? I don't imagine there's a lot of people who would say, well, sure, so you're might even take it as a teaching moment to say, you're behaving like this, and you're doing this to me, and you think I'm going to buy you ice cream? That's not how life works, son. How should God treat us with our behavior? There's a couple verses in Scripture that tell us that. Colossians 1 says, once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. That was our status with God. Or in the book of Isaiah, we read this. Your sins have separated you from your God. Your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. Your lips have spoken lies, and your tongue mutters wicked things. Their feet rush into sin. Their thoughts are evil thoughts. Our offenses are many in your sight, and our sins testify against us. According to what they have done, he will repay. There's a wall between us and God because of what he's done. A wall of separation because of our sins, where he does not need to listen to our prayers or should not acknowledge our prayers. So how did we ever think he would listen when we pray? Things have changed because of what verse 18 says in a three-word phrase. It says, pray in the Spirit. Pray in the Spirit. What does that mean, pray in the Spirit? Well, what has the Holy Spirit done in our lives that would change things? What has the Holy Spirit revealed to us? It says in 1 Corinthians 2, we have not received the Spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we may understand what God has freely given us. The Holy Spirit has revealed something that God's given as a gift. And what is that? Galatians 1 says, the Lord Jesus Christ gave himself for our sins to rescue us from the present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father. The Holy Spirit has revealed a door in the wall. A door in the wall that's been made through Jesus Christ, where he took our sins and our guilt, and he deposited them on a cross where they are gone forever. And we're forgiven. Where we have access to God. In fact, Ephesians says, in Christ and through faith in him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. There is a door, a gate, Jesus called himself, in the wall through which we can come to our God and our Father. And the Holy Spirit, when we pray in the Spirit, is the one who has revealed this so that we now know it, believe in it, and live in it. In fact, we're now his children. You know, I recently saw a movie that reminded me of a scene at the White House decades ago. Maybe some of you remember. When JFK, John F. Kennedy, was the president, he had a couple little kids. And it was reminded to me in this movie, his son used to play under his desk as he would do work during the day. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine if you were JFK's son and you could play at the president's desk? And any little thing, perhaps, you could point over and go, hey, Dad, look at this car. Look at this. I got this toy. Excellent. To be acknowledged. Yeah, the president was busy. Yet the president's son had his ear many times. You're like that kid. How many kids get to be under the desk of the president? That's a privilege. But all of God's children play under his desk as he does his work during the day. And they have his ear and his attention. What a privilege this is. We would pray. So now we get down to the thrust of our question today, a third question. Not only will you do it, and also will God listen, but who needs our prayers? Who needs our prayers? There's kind of two audiences here that Paul talks about. He says, with this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints. All the saints need your prayers. Your fellow believers, your brothers and sisters in faith. I think it's very fitting that we come upon this sermon at the time we do, as we're kind of coming out of all these COVID times. The past 15 months, of course, have been very different and very challenging. And when we think about how challenging it's been with churches' interaction, I think you'd agree with me that our church interaction has been affected by this. When we had church outside even, we could gather, we could sing, we could mix with one another, we could talk after church. But even then, we didn't have all of our things going on. Things were canceled, shut down, things were changed, things were postponed. And what happened after church? Well, we were outside, often everyone packing in, and we go home. Everything was kind of shortened. How was that time for you with your church family? They say, especially if you have a dating situation going on, either absence makes the heart grow fonder, or out of sight, out of mind. Which was it for you? Did it draw you closer to your church family? Did it make you pray more fervently for people in our congregation? Or was it more a case of out of sight, out of mind? I think as we come back together and have many more normal circumstances now, what a fitting reminder this is about how we pray for all of the saints. And this is a great time also probably for an encouragement to keep your pictorial directory, your church pictorial directory close by. Because of those 125 people, most of whom have pictures in there and names, as you page through that, your prayers will be prompted. You will see faces and see needs to pray about. And also an encouragement to talk with other people in our congregation. Stay updated. Say hi to people maybe you don't mix with, but that your circles don't always naturally gravitate toward. To know them. To know their needs. So that we can pray for all of the saints here. Now there's a second audience also that we wouldn't want to forget about that Paul mentions too. In verse 19, he also says, pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. Can you imagine why Paul would need the prayers of those Ephesian Christians? Remember all the challenges that the early church and the Roman Empire? There was danger. There was persecution. There was ridicule. There was oppression. Paul says, don't forget about me. Pray for my ministry. Pray for my words. Pray that God would bless my ministry as I bring this. It's interesting that in Ephesus, that's the only place where Paul mentions, and he has an interesting comment where he says, that's where I had to face wild beasts. When we look at that verse in the Bible, we go, what are the wild beasts? Did Paul actually have to go in the arena and face wild beasts? Or maybe was he talking about Acts 19, where in Ephesus he had a very hard go-around with the city leaders, a lot of oppression. We don't know. But Paul says, I had to face wild beasts there. Pray for me. Pray for my ministry. Pray for my words. I have a request for you today. Can you pray for your pastor? Can you pray for our church's ministries? There's no one looking for any sympathetic violin music here today. But the last year has been difficult for pastors and ministers. It's been a difficult time trying to interact with the flock. People are not so keen for a visit, interaction, normal things that we do at conversations and meetings and gatherings. It's been a time when lots of things have been canceled or postponed. There certainly has been a different spirit of outreach. A lot of people in our community are looking for visitors and home visits and gatherings to come to that they're invited to. It's been a difficult time to do a lot of church ministry and Bible class and sit at the church on Sundays at times. Pray for your pastor. Pray for our ministry. That God would keep it moving forward as we fulfill our mission and our purpose for which he has brought us together and put us here on this corner. Not only that, but of course we have another call worker here and another ministry. We have a preschool ministry that's going to be entering its second year. I don't know if you prayed for that lately. Can you pray for our preschool ministry and for our preschool director? It's a time for publicity and advertising and open houses. Can you pray? pray as we enter that second year that from Monday through Friday, a wonderful gospel ministry is happening where children learn about their Savior and grow in their little faith. Can you pray for our director who works hard during the week so that that ministry can happen? And that ministry is very important to our congregation because it's not just a Monday to Friday ministry. But for people who don't have a church home or are not active in their church home, we're looking to bridge them and invite them Sundays to come to hear the word about his family. Can you pray for that bridge and for that ministry so that we might get to share the gospel with more and more people through that ministry? I know our director would welcome your prayers. And maybe one more circle of application, too. This is a time of year in our synod where we can think of the new pastors and teachers as well. Our latest Forward in Christ magazine highlighted the graduates from Wisconsin Lutheran Seminary in Mequon, Wisconsin, and Martin Luther College in New Ulm, Minnesota. There are 33 pastor calls that were given to graduates at our seminary. 33. Men who will be going on various pastoral calls. 160 teacher calls were given to teachers to go to our Lutheran schools. Quite a few vacancies have been made. But those young people are eager and they are ready to go out and to light the world up and to bring the gospel to other people. Well, let me ask you this. Can you think of what it would be like if you were starting your ministry now as a pastor or as a Lutheran teacher? Can you imagine what would lie ahead of you? Your ministry, with the way our world is going, can you imagine the ministries of these young people? They're going to be canceled in a lot of places. They are going to be opposed and oppressed and spoken against, just like our readings said today. Can you imagine being a pastor for the next 40 or 50 years, what this world is going to be like and how it will react to your message? They are eager and they are ready. When Paul says, pray for my ministry, don't forget to pray for our wider synod ministries in many places as the word goes out to the world. But finally today, maybe a couple helps would be fitting as well. On the back of your bulletin, maybe that's something to clip and to keep and to copy. Some people are visual, and some people need some aids by which they can be helped. Maybe it would help you to keep prayers. So that when the time comes for you to fold your hands and bow your heads and say, it's not great for other people, maybe you don't want to forget about someone. Maybe that can prompt you to remember for whom you want to pray. You can jot down those as you think. Or maybe if you're a bit more organized person, you could even have a board at your home. A small board, a little bulletin board or something. My prayer list. Or prayer requests where you could even rotate through current prayers for other people, for things that need your prayers as well to our Lord. And as we do that, may God hear, may God listen, may God answer, and may God bless. Pray for one another. We know that they will benefit from your prayers. Amen. Please rise. Now that the peace that surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the true faith, the life everlasting. Amen. We'll respond to this word of God on pages 8 and 9 with the song, We Praise You, O God.
Thank you.
page 10, and we're going to recognize the elected men in our congregation. I invite them to come forward at this time. Dear friends in Christ, in holy baptism, our Lord Jesus Christ liberated you from sin and death, and he made you members of his body, the church. And through word and sacrament, you have been nourished in your faith. You also have been elected to positions of service to the Lord on behalf of our church. The Lord has entrusted you with an office that you are to carry out as his servant and according to his word. St. Paul wrote concerning service in the church, "We have different gifts according to the grace given us. If a man's gift is prophesying, let him use it in proportion to his faith. If it is serving, let him serve. If it is teaching, let him teach. If it is encouraging, let him encourage. If it is contributing to the needs of others, let him give generously. If it is leadership, let him govern diligently. If it is showing mercy, let him do it cheerfully." So the Lord seeks faithfulness from all who serve. Scriptures say, "It is required that those who have been given a trust must prove faithful." And the Lord does not seek from us what he has not given to us. But when he gives a gift, his will is that we use it faithfully, to his glory and for the benefit of his people. So you also, as servants of Jesus and workers in our congregation, are to set your own families and our whole church an example of a Christian life. Make the word of God your foundation and guide, and search it daily for comfort and instruction. So that our congregation may be assured of your willingness to serve, I ask you in the presence of God and of our church here today, will you diligently and faithfully carry out the office that's been entrusted to you, according to the ability that God has given to you? If so, answer, "Yes, with the help of God."
Yes, with the help of God.
So I install you in your positions at St. Peter Lutheran Church in the name of the Father and the Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Leo Schultz, chairman of our congregation. Mike Farley, treasurer. Jeff Hansen, elder. Ken Hoffmeyer, head elder. Bruno Stutz, elder. Josh Lorman, vice president. Barry Burkhart, assistant to the trustee. Robert Klein, secretary of the congregation. John Barber, Christian education. Our other men who are not able to be here with us today are listed there on page 10. That would be Travis Hamilton, who is the chairman of our trustees, Evan Blankenship, who is our evangelism chairman, and Michael May, who is our financial secretary. So members of St. Peter, I urge you to regard these fellow believers as servants of Jesus and God's gift to us here in our church. Pray for them, support them, and help them so that through their gospel ministry, more and more people will be reached for Christ in this kingdom through our church. We pray. Merciful God, our lives are open before you, and you hear our promises, and we ask you now to send your Holy Spirit into the hearts of these servants so that they may carry out their duties with diligence and wisdom. Give them a spirit of devotion and prayer, that in every time of need they may present their requests to you. Help them to be examples of what is good, that by their lives they may build up our church and give the enemies of the church no cause for complaint. Make them a blessing to us. Help them to work with their pastor and with one another. And grant that by their service the unity of our church may be strengthened, your name hallowed, your kingdom enlarged, and your will be done. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Go in peace. Special prayers today for Deb and Jeff Schatzer, They mentioned that a member of theirs back at their home church, who was 16 years old, Israel Gabe, had a liver transplant in the hospital, not doing that well. We pray for him. Also at their home church, Maria Tillotson, a very elderly member, fell and broke many bones. She was going to be in the hospital for quite a while. And their goddaughter Mandy and husband Mike had a miracle baby, and we offer a prayer of thanks for that. In our own congregation, Patty Sweetman is undergoing some very serious health issues, and so we offer a prayer for her today as well. Heavenly Father, we come to you in our Savior Jesus' name, truly thankful for the privilege of speaking to you in prayer. Teach us to avail ourselves of your goodness and blessings by crying out to you day and night. Our souls are weary and our hearts ache from the sins that afflict us and the temptations that assail us. Give us a courageous faith that boldly lays all the burdens of our hearts and lives before your throne of grace. Also, Lord God, we pray that you would lead us to pray for those around us, those in our church, those in our community, those in our neighborhoods, and those that need us. We pray that our prayers would be accepted because of the forgiveness and the blood of Jesus, our Savior. Also, make the Bible the treasure of our hearts and cause our prayers to be guided by the counsel and the promises that that gives to us. Also, Lord God, Heavenly Father, you are the giver and sustainer of life. We ask that you would visit these Christian brothers and sisters with your compassion. We pray that it might be your will that they may experience rapid healing and recovery from surgery, from falls, from weakness. Lend strength to the members of their families so that they may bear up under their present ordeals. And comfort them with the everlasting comfort of the gospel as they live out their days in peace, having the assurance that while weakness and illness remind us that we are all mortal because of our sin, yet all who put their trust in Jesus have full pardon and everlasting life. And Lord of life, we marvel at the wonderful way in which you bring children into this world. Accept our thanks for holding your protecting hand over this mother in childbirth and bringing joy to these parents with the gift of a child. Bless this child and receive them into your family through the sacrament of baptism. Protect them from dangers of body and soul, and give the parents the love, wisdom, and means to care for this child you have entrusted to them. We pray this in your name as we also pray together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
O Lord, our Heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, you have brought us safely to this new day. Defend us with your mighty power, and grant that this day we neither fall into sin nor run into any kind of danger. And in all we do, direct us to what is right in your sight, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us praise the Lord. God's house. We're going to watch the March edition of the Wells Connection here before we go today for just a few minutes. We're a little behind on these. For some reason, we didn't watch them outside. And so we're just going to watch a couple in the weeks coming up that are not Communion Sundays. So Travis Hamilton was not able to be with us here for church, so give me one moment and we'll watch that.